This is Christine Fruitt, and she's from the University of Florida, where she is the Scholarly Communications Librarian. And she also holds a law degree from the University of Illinois. I don't have my notes in front of me.
JD from Southern Illinois University, and then my master's is from University of Illinois.
Yeah, okay, gotcha. All right. And so she's going to talk to you about all kinds of issues that you might be maybe running up against when you're finishing your grad school. And just go ahead and take it over.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Beth, for introducing me and for having me. It was really an honor to come up where it's actually fall-like and get out of the Florida heat. A little bit more sun would have been nice, but that's all right. I'm very happy to be here, and so thank you for joining us this afternoon. As Beth indicated, we are going to be talking about copyright and issues that you may be confronting as you are working on your terminal project. So just by show of hands, how many of you are working on a doctoral, like a dissertation? Rest of you are masters, working on a thesis? Okay. So I will probably frequently be saying the word dissertation. Doesn't mean it's not applicable to those of you who are master students. A lot of this, some of it may not be applicable, particularly when we're talking. Now, do they deposit their works in NC Docs also, the master's theses also?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But probably don't, not, what about with ProQuest? Do they deposit things there as well?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, then Valerie here is from the graduate school. So
wonderful. Okay. Okay. Well, good. Well, then this will be of use to you as well, as you probably get a lot of these kinds of questions from students who come through your office. So, so just kind of a, there we go. A little outline of what we're going to be talking about. The majority of the talk, in the first, probably, 60-70% of it is going to be talking about using the copyrighted works of others in your research. Whether it's a figure or someone else's article, maybe it's your own article that you wrote that you're wanting. That's what we're going to be talking about, is using the copyrighted works of others. When is it okay to do that without getting permission from the copyright holder, and how to evaluate that? We're going to be talking about fair use. I don't know how many of you have heard of that concept. It's a very important one to be familiar with. And what to do if you do find that you are in a situation where you need to get permission. What are some of the steps to follow? And also encourage you to allow enough time to do that. It's not necessarily a quick process to get permission if you find yourself needing to do that. Then we're going to kind of switch gears, kind of flip it around, and talk about you as copyright holders. As authors of this dissertation or thesis, you yourself are going to be a copyright holder and are going to have some things to think about in terms of publishing and how you go about actually publishing this research, which immediately will be both through depositing in the repository and also placing it within the ProQuest database, and what that means for you and your rights as a copyright holder, and even beyond, should you want to publish portions of or your entire work in later publications, such as maybe journal articles, or even make it part of a larger monograph, and what that means for you. So those are kind of the topics that we're going to be talking about. When I do these kinds of workshops, I don't want to just stand here and lecture you. I can do that. I can do it quite well. But I would much rather this be a conversation. So please, if questions come up that are things that you need clarification on, or you have specific examples, interrupt me. This doesn't have to just be like you said, take copious notes and just have to listen to me. Please, pepper me with your questions. Don't say, feel like you have to say them to the end. I would much rather address them as they come up. As far as taking notes, I have provided Beth with these slides. Feel free, I don't know if you've taken any kind of sign-in sheet or anything today, or if you want to make this available, you have my permission to do that. So if there's some links or things, maybe, given how far away you all are seated, you can't quite get copied down in time, I'll make sure that, or Beth will make sure that you get a copy of these slides today, so that if there's links or anything you want to refer back to later, you can do so. Any questions before we get started? And you can all hear me fine? And can you, I'm assuming the recording equipment can hear me just fine? So let's go ahead and get started. I don't know why that button doesn't want to work. So talking first about using copyrighted works of others. So one of the first things you should ask when you are you know, looking at something that you want to incorporate into your dissertation. And so we're going to kind of bore you for a few minutes with just some copyright basics, how to tell if a work actually is copyrighted, whether it is something that is eligible for copyright protection, is that copyright protection still in effect, so how long is copyright. We're going to just kind of cover some basics. So I'm going to start off first with the statutory definition of what kinds of works can be copyrighted. We'll also tell you that copyright law is a matter of federal law, not state law. So some of the things that we talk about today in terms of what kind of work is copyrighted, how long, even fair use is going to be the same. So if you leave North Carolina and go to Florida or go to Michigan or California or anywhere in the United States, the law is going to be the same, the things that we talk about today. The Copyright Act that is currently in place was enacted in 1976. And which, particularly when we're talking about electronic items, it sometimes gets tricky because a lot of the modes of delivering content were not contemplated back then. But what that act says is that a work is eligible for copyright protection so long as it is an original work of authorship, fixed in any tangible medium of expression now known or later developed. So that kind of anticipates new developments and new technologies. But what does that really mean? Let's break this down a little bit. Sorry, I thought I had another slide in there. Original works of authorship, of course, you know, being original does not mean that it does not necessarily incorporate anything that's already in existence. Original really means that it has some level of creativity involved. So it might be a new work that maybe incorporates pieces and parts of other works, but perhaps has been arranged or has some additional content added to it that gives, you know, rise to the level of being original. Fixed in any tangible medium of expression, essentially is something that can be read, heard, seen, somehow perceived. Now, the statute does help us out by listing out the different kinds of works that fall within that definition. A lot of these works that are eligible for copyright protection are kind of no-brainers, things you've probably thought of before, but there may be some things listed here that you may not have been aware are protected by copyright. So of course we know that text-based works, so author articles, books, poems, things of that nature, of course, are protected by copyright. Music copyright is rather complicated, however, because there's different levels of copyright protection. So you might have one person may have a copyright in the actual score, the musical arrangement. Someone may also hold a copyright in the lyrics. There's that portion. And if it's a performance, there may also be a copyright in that performance. And so different levels and layers of copyright when you're talking about musical works. Dramatic works, so that would be plays, operas, those types of things. Pantomimes and choreography are also copyrighted, as are all different types of artwork, so sculpture, paintings, photographs, and, you know, all kinds of different artworks. Movies, of course, and again, movies are another type of work that has many different layers of copyright. You're going to have the script and the cinematography. There's a lot of different things there. Usually, though, all those are assigned to the production company. Other kinds of sound recordings of maybe, you know, oral presentations and such, architectural works, and even software. Software is also protected by copyright.
I have a question.
Yeah.
This might be obvious, but if somebody makes something, writes a poem or whatever, is it automatically?
We're going to get to that, but I mean, the short answer is yes. Yes, it is. So what is not protected? Mere ideas. Things that have not actually been, you know, come into fruition as one of these copyrighted works are not protected by copyright. So sometimes we will hear about stories out of Hollywood, someone claiming copyright infringement because someone stole their idea for a movie. Idea, not protected. Titles, so that's why we see, sometimes we'll see songs with the same song title, or books. What frequently comes into, particularly with book titles, is trademark protection. Another kind of intellectual property, but a different kind of protection. Trademark sometimes will protect titles. Copyright does not. So, for instance, I could not write a book with Harry Potter in the title, not because the title of the Harry Potter series is copyrighted, but because Harry Potter is trademarked. So sometimes people get confused about titles, and so I just want to make that distinguish between trademark and copyright. mere facts, things, you know, systems of measure, you know, how many cups are in a gallon, or how many ounces are in a gallon, the fact that the sky is blue, you know, things like that are not protected by copyright. Historical facts, why, you know, you can see books, you know, for this, you know, history, for example, you know, lots of different people can write about particular historical events and perhaps repeat the exact same facts over and over again because facts themselves are not. Included within that definition of facts, though, are raw data. So just, the, you know, not the arrangement or necessarily incorporation or application of that data, but just the raw numbers itself. But you do have to be careful that a lot of times there might be some kind of policy or agreement that speaks to the ownership or use of that data. You know, North Carolina, here they probably have an intellectual property policy that addresses the ownership of data. In fact, that came up as an issue in a meeting I had with folks earlier today, is about the ownership of data. Or you may be working on a grant, and the provisions of that grant might speak to the ownership of data. So if you are working on a research project that is going to result in a dissertation or thesis that utilizes the data, it's important to talk with either your faculty advisor or be aware of any kind of policy or grant that might attach to use of that data, citation of that data, and so on. Processes, so you can't copyright a recipe, for example, so, and other kinds of processes. Works prepared by the federal government as a class of works are not protected by copyright. I always encourage, especially faculty when they're teaching or even students, you know, if you're looking for a particular image or looking for a particular map, always see if some agency of the federal government has perhaps taken that picture or produced that graph or that map, because those are not protected by copyright and you can use them freely without having to worry about needing permission. And then other works that are also considered to be in the public domain. We frequently refer to works of the federal government as being in the public domain, but other works that are in the what we call the public domain. Public domain refers to kind of that area where works fall once their term of copyright protection has expired. And we are going to talk about how long copyright protection lasts. So that's next. Copyright does expire. It just does currently last for a really, really long time. And as I said, once it expires, works fall into what we call the public domain. Can kind of break it down into three chunks for purposes of determining when works, you know, for calculating how long copyright protection lasts. I also do want to clarify when I'm talking about the public domain, I'm talking only about works first published or produced in the United States. Different countries have different laws about public domain. In fact, some countries don't have public domain at all. So this is important to remember when you're evaluating whether a work is in the public domain or not. Make sure you're looking at a U.S. work. If we're talking about a foreign work, you have to look at other different treaties and foreign laws to determine their status. Generally, if you have a work that was published first before January 1st, 1923, I'm not going to say all because there are exceptions, but generally if it was published first before 1923, it is in the public domain. You can feel pretty comfortable that you can go ahead and include it in whatever you're working on without having to get permission. After 1978, the copyright term is the life of the author plus 70 years. So really anything published after 1978, rest assured that's still protected by copyright in the United States. Then this big chunk of time between 1923 and 1977, it's all over the map. And that's due to the fact that the law changed, not only during that time, but also, you know, subsequently affecting older works. Between 1923 and 1977, we had requirements of registration and notice. And the term of protection was also much shorter, only 28 years. And so in order to be entitled to that first chunk of 28 years, someone actually had to have copyright notice. Notice was usually done by actually including either the words copyright to or copyright by and the name of the copyright holder, or that little symbol of the C in the circle. That used to be required. Also, you had to register your copyright with the Copyright Office in Washington, D.C. Then once that 28 years expired, you had the obligation to file a renewal in order to get. So a lot of folks either didn't do the registration and notice during that time, or they neglected to renew. So when you're talking about something between 1923 and 1977, It sometimes, you know, and if you are using the quantity of a work or using it in such a way that you might need permission, this might be something you'll want to look at, is to research whether or not it is still in, even protected by copyright. How do you research that? Well, it's not, for me it's easy, but for average folks it's not, because the Copyright Office in DC has not digitized all of its records going back yet. But different libraries, different institutions such as HathiTrust, Pennsylvania has been going back and scanning and doing OCR on the old big paper registries. So you can find the registries online, but it's not a perfect system for searching. Stanford also maintains a renewal database, but I have even found that has been at times incomplete or imperfect. So. It can sometimes be tricky to determine whether or not something is still protected if first published between those years. A really good resource that I point people to for kind of navigating this and making sense of it is at Cornell University, they maintain this public domain chart. It's set up in a really easy to read format with a couple columns across where you can look up, okay, what year this work I'm dealing with was first published, what the requirements were in that year, and what it means if those requirements were or were not complied with. It's a really good starting point, and I do have that link up here. Frequently people think that out of print means out of copyright. That is not true. Just because something is no longer commercially available, there's no used copies available, the publisher is out of business, the author is dead, whatever the case may be, still protected by copyright. Which is also kind of a problem as well, and which is one of the criticisms for how long copyright protection lasts. We're going to be talking about fair use in a few minutes. That is a fact that's going to make your fair use case, however, really, really strong, where you're in a situation where something isn't commercially available, or you have a publisher or author who is not identifiable or findable or contact. I don't know if contactable is a word, but I say it often enough, it should just be a word. Another frequent question I get from graduate students and faculty members alike is a kind of confusion about copyright infringement and plagiarism. A lot of times people think, well, as long as I cite it, I'm good. Well, citation is certainly necessary and important for purposes of avoiding plagiarism. Plagiarism is a matter of academic policy. Copyright is a matter of law. So you can be sued for copyright infringement. You really can't be sued for plagiarism. You can, get in trouble ethically. You might get kicked out of school or lose your job or so on. And you can have one without the other. Plagiarism is using someone's works. It doesn't matter how much, if it's one sentence or four pages, or one figure or all the figures, and using them in such a way that it presents it as your own work and not giving credit to the person that actually said those words, created that figure. So it's important to always, always, always cite something, even if it's out of copyright, even if it's a public domain work, something that was produced by a federal agency, you should always, always cite it. And that's for purposes of avoiding plagiarism. Even if it's something you authored, frequently students, especially doctoral students, are already published authors. They may have already written a couple articles, and they want to use portions of an article that they wrote previously in their dissertation, and they don't think they have to cite themselves. Well, it's my words, I wrote it. There is a such thing as self-plagiarism. You can plagiarize yourself. So even if it's your own work, if it's something that you wrote before, definitely cite to it. Even if it's a paper you wrote for a class, you want to acknowledge that this is something that you previously wrote and give as much identifying information about it as you can. Yes?
How do you know if you're infringing upon someone's rights to copyright?
We're going to talk about
awesome.
That. Yeah. So copyright infringement then is using, so that's what plagiarism is. Copyright infringement is using a work, and typically we look at things like quantity or how you're using it, and using it without permission, if you are in a situation where permission is needed. Permission is not always needed. We have this wonderful thing that we're going to move to next called fair use, which allows for, if your use qualifies as a fair use, you can use something without having to get permission. Still have to cite to it, want to avoid plagiarism, but don't have to get permission. So there are, like I said, there are, and free, and I'll tell you, most of you, probably how you are using copyrighted works of others, probably you are probably not in a situation where you're going to need permission. I work with graduate students at University of Florida, and in the last 5 years that I've been down there, I mean honestly I've probably met with about 300 different doctoral students, and I can think of only two situations where they have been in a situation where they have to get permission. Generally, what you are probably wanting to use or incorporate into your works probably is going to qualify as fair use. I'm just going to put out there ahead of time that usually you're not going to, and I will even tell you what those two examples were in case you're, you know, by way of example of when you should be concerned about getting permission. Any questions about this? Do you understand? I know it's kind of, it can be complicated or confusing. Understand the difference between the two. So always cite. Just know. If I'm including it, if I wrote it, if someone else wrote it, I need to cite to it. And cite always to the original source if you can. Whether or not you need to get permission or not is a question that you should be thinking about.
That does bring up a question.
Yeah.
So with the like citation stuff, if I'm reading something you wrote about something that she wrote, you want to say her and not you, even though I got it from your book? Or is that like a different class?
If you read an article that's talking about a study that was published 25 years ago, I mean, go ahead and cite to that article that's talking about it. That's fine. That's fine.
The other thing related to that, though, and I ran into this just this morning, is if you don't go back to your original source on that, whoever cited it, like, it may not have
cited it correctly. Yeah, and that is true.
And I had, because I was having to look up a reference, the citation was wrong, and their interpretation was way different than the way that I read it too. So it's always safer to go back to that original source and read it yourself. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that's just good research practice. That's just good research practice. But you know, I think more in terms of like images. So if there is a famous photograph included in a book, how I might cite that is, and you're including that photograph in your paper, I would cite it as giving, you know, the title of the original work and the original artist. And then say, you know, something like, in, you know, parenthetically, or however, whatever style manual you're using might dictate how these have, might say, as reproduced in, and then give citation to the, you know, to wherever you found it in. Because you may not have the original, you're not necessarily going to have the original artwork or the original photograph in front of you,
right,
but have found it somewhere else. But I would give, you know, particularly with artworks, you know, give credit to the original, and then, you know, as reproduced in, or whatever language, like I said, you want to use, or a citation manual that you're following uses. Good questions. So one last thing. So in a situation before we jump to fair use. So before, a couple things you should be thinking about before including copyrighted works in your own research, in your own paper. First of all, you know, review all the materials that you are wanting to incorporate and start thinking about this early. You know, as you're getting really into the writing, you know, process and deciding what sources you want to, you know, include, start evaluating early on whether or not these are items that are in the public domain. Okay, they are. I don't need to worry about, you know, how much of this I'm using or how I'm using it. Is it even something that's, you know, still copyrighted, or is it a type of work? So, you know, be looking at your quotations, your photographs, your charts. Anything that you are incorporating, and start doing that analysis early on, because I'm going to say this over and over again, if you are in a situation where you have to get permission, it is not a quick process. And I have dealt with many a frantic, like I said, thankfully they have been rare, two instances where we've had to get permission, and because it was so late in the game, it was supplementary enough, they just ended up pulling the content out altogether. But I've had many a harried student come see me, because I have an overly cautious ETD office. Every time someone includes something that's copyrighted in their dissertation, they automatically send them to me. And I've been telling them they need to, they have kind of a stock email or a stock notice that they send these students, and it's just like fire and brimstone sounding. And these students come to me in a panic, thinking that they're going to have, you know, they're just trying to graduate. They've already defended. They're just kind of going through the final steps to graduate. And they're like, oh my gosh, I have to get permission. I have, I mean, we're talking 2-3 weeks and they need to be done. And usually I'm like, you need to get permission. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen 2-3 weeks. But like I said, usually it's like, you don't need to get permission. This is fair use. Don't worry about it. And they're just like, why did ETD send me over here? I don't know. Because they are overly cautious. So review all your materials early on and just determine, you know, are these in the public domain? In which case, okay, I'm just need to make sure you have proper citation. Don't need to worry about permissions. Also, as you are looking for sources to include, definitely look at, if you can, works that are in, that are, you know, perhaps still copyrighted, but have been licensed or published in such a way that, you know, you have already been kind of given permission in advance. So looking at things that are published perhaps in open access journals or are located in an open access or publicly accessible repository, or perhaps they have been licensed through Creative Commons. This is particularly important for images and such. You can look for Creative Commons licensed works as well, which basically is kind of a grant of permission to the world by whoever the copyright holder is for works to be used, typically in an educational or non-commercial purpose, which, you know, your all works is going to qualify for. Again, a quick question that frequently comes up is, what about using my own works? A lot of times, particularly with our doctoral students, they've already published, which is great, but they, as most authors who publish with commercial publishers nowadays have done, have given away their copyright to the publishers. But a lot of publishers, how many of you have published and have already published an article? When you published, were you the first name author? Yes. So did you sign a copyright agreement with the publisher? Did you read it? Chances are, unless it was an open access publisher or a publisher who uses Creative Commons licensing, chances are you've probably signed all copyright away to that publisher. So if you want to use that article, and I'm saying this because this happens very frequently, that students will want to use an entire article as a chapter in their dissertation. Well, they've now signed copyright away to those publishers. Now they're in a situation where they have to get permission to use their very own work in their dissertation, which is why it's very important to read those copyright transfer agreements and not sign everything away if you can avoid it. However, for students working on a dissertation or thesis, thankfully, many publishers have a policy on the books that specifically allows students to reuse their articles without permission. So consult it's website, it's open for everyone to use, but you all use LibGuides here, uh-huh. Don't you? So I have a LibGuide that I maintain at the University of Florida. And I have a page just for graduate students. And on that page, I have been maintaining a chart, a publisher policy chart. And I can send Beth the link, and she can certainly share it with you all, that lists publisher policies regarding reuse of your own articles in your own research. And most of them allow it. Some actually require you to notify them, and they will. But I mean, permission is automatically granted, but you actually do have to get permission, but it's automatic. They just want to know that this article is going to be appearing in a dissertation. Others, it's just a matter of policy, just know you can do it. But usually require you to cite, you know, and sometimes they want the citation to be in a very specific format, including a link to the published article. So if you're in that situation, I encourage you to, you know, go to the publisher, you know, the journal's website, and look for a policy page or a link to a policy, or you can even sometimes search the site, you know, for about that, or just contact the publisher and see what. But most of them do permit reuse of articles in a dissertation or thesis. Another thing that will be important is, and we're going to talk about this later, is publishing your dissertation in that same chart that I maintain. I have another column about that. Yes.
And that actually was where my question was headed, particularly for people who are doing a manuscript dissertation.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I don't know if you want to wait till later.
I'll wait till later, but I will address that You know, if you certainly, you know, interrupt me, you know, and ask me if the way I'm describing it doesn't make sense or doesn't answer your question, but I do get that. Yes, sir.
What about, say, you use an illustration or a picture or something that you modify that?
That's probably going to be fair use, and you probably wouldn't need permission, but we're just now getting ready to get into that. So for all other cases, you have determined, okay, what I'm using is still copyrighted, it's not in the public domain, it's not licensed for my use, it's not my own work that the publisher has already said I'm going to use it. So for all other cases, which is probably going to be most of what you're, then you're going to look at it and say, okay, is my use fair use? And if it's not, I need to get permission. How do I go about that? So that's what we're going to dive into to next. So let's talk about fair use. So what is fair use? Fair use is a statute in the Copyright Act allowing for the use of copyrighted works, provided it's for a number of purposes, such as parody, personal use, research, education, and so long as the four factors of fair use balance in your favor. And so when doing a fair use analysis, that's really what it is, and how I frequently tell people to think about it is imagine kind of an old-timey balance, and in fact you're going to see figures of this, where on the one side you have the copyright holder's rights. So the copyright holder, you know, has all these rights to sell their work, to copy their work, to modify their work, to transmit it, to perform it. And so that's, you know, all their exclusive rights versus your right of fair use, which is to use that copyrighted material in some way without permission. And there's different things you need to evaluate. And as you're doing this evaluation, you're going to drop weights on one side or the other. Okay, does this tip more in favor of the copyright holder, or does this tip more in favor of my right of fair use? And when you get through all four factors, kind of seeing, all right, does it tip more heavily in favor of fair use, or does it tip more heavily in favor of the copyright holder, in which case I probably need to get permission or perhaps look for some substitute or pull it out altogether. We're going to talk about each of these four factors, each of these things you kind of need to think about and analyze. We're going to go over them in mind-numbing detail. But in short form, the four factors are, first of all, why am I using this? What is the purpose of my use? The second is, what's the nature of the work that I'm using? What kind of work is it? What is the content? The third, how much of that copyrighted work am I using? And finally, is my use of this copyrighted work going to have any effect upon the market for the original? Basically, am I somehow going to be depriving the copyright holder of any profits by virtue of my using this? So let's go over each of these in more detail. So, purpose and character of the use. You know, why am I using this? Certainly for a dissertation or thesis, definitely this is going to be an educational use. And really the key here is transformational use. Am I using the work in some new way, for some new purpose, new audience, than was intended by the original author or creator? Those are the kinds of things that are going to tip that balance strongly in your favor of fair use. If you're using it for commercial purposes, that's going to tip more in favor of the copyright holder. The key thing here, though, to remember is that all four of these factors you need to consider in total. So it's where, after going through all four, where the balance of it tips, not where any one factor tips. So what this means is that commercial uses can still be fair uses. So if perhaps in the future you're working on other projects, just because something is, in fact, most of the cases out there, the court cases, on fair use have been, and they have found fair use, have been commercial, have involved commercial uses. But there has either been such an overwhelmingly transformative, or, you know, the other three factors, when looking at those, has tipped so strongly in favor of fair use, didn't matter that the reason why someone was using it was to make money. Because so as we go through this, just remember that this is going through each one individually, but then seeing where the balance of all four tip. So that no one factor is a slam dunk. Educational transformative use is a pretty, you know, based on recent court cases, a pretty heavy weight on your side. So on this factor, y'all probably are going to be just fine. The second factor, what is the nature of the work? Definitely creative works, so musical works, photography, architectural drawings, and then like protected a little bit more fiercely than things that are more factual, informational, technical in nature. Probably a lot of what you are using is going to be things that are, you know, scientific, informational, you know, data-based, fact-based, information-based documents, as opposed to things that are more creative. Again, does not mean creative works, use of creative works is never going to be fair use. Lots of examples of commercial uses of creative works that have been found to be fair use. But just kind of going through all the different things. So, you know, generally scholarly works is what you all are probably going to be incorporating into your writings, and that's going to generally going to be fall in favor of fair use in this particular factor. How much of it are you using? Of course, the less you can use, the better. Smaller quantities are always going to be favored over larger quantities of a work. And looking at, you know, so you want to make sure that what you are using is really essential to your research. It's not just supplemental stuff. You're not trying to just achieve a certain page count, and not just throwing a bunch of extraneous information in. There are certainly situations where even a small quantity could possibly be infringing. An example from this morning, so I apologize to those of you who heard this example, is that perhaps you have you're working maybe on an artist. Your dissertation might be about an artist, and you have a book that is maybe 400 pages in length, but you're wanting to incorporate into your dissertation the 20 color plates that are in the center of that book. So 20 pages is really small in comparison to a 400 page book, but those 20 pages are so quintessentially essential to that work that even that small quantity would probably be infringing. In fact, I probably would say in that situation you either need to just maybe pick a couple, or we're going to have to get permission to use them. Although if it's old artwork, you know, that's artwork in the public domain, and we can get into that as well. And I'll just kind of as an aside, public domain works that are published in a public domain work doesn't lose its public domain status simply because it has been published in something new. So the art book is a good example. So if someone writes a book in 2015 about a 15th century painter, and they have photographs of those 15th century paintings in their book, those paintings don't suddenly fall out of public domain status just because someone includes that in a new book. And so then it becomes a situation where, you know, and them just merely taking a photograph of it, that's really, they really don't get a, and we run into this a lot with museums, they don't get a copyright in that photograph by taking just a mere picture of a public domain work. So that's probably, in that situation, I'd probably say, yeah, go ahead and use them and not worry so much about quantity. Yeah, I knew that was going to bring up questions. Kind of one of those confusing little gray areas where we have to sit down and look at it and kind of talk through it and stuff. So you first, ma'am. Yes.
So with like museums and stuff, do they try, like say I wanted to use a picture of Starry Night and the museum has a picture of that.
On their website, yeah.
So I would attribute it to Van Gogh, but I would say as reproduced.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah,
and it'd be fine. Like,
yes,
like,
oh, absolutely, absolutely. No, they can't. They really can't. They try to, but they can't. Just taking a mere pick. And like I said, museums. There's been a lot of scholarship on this, and there have been court cases on this about museums wanting to claim copyright in just photographs of paintings, and they really can't. I mean, it's pretty thin, if at all, copyright. Now, if you find it on their website, you know, then it gets into what gets sometimes tricky. And that, you know, is you have to look at, you know, whether or not by entering a website, by virtue of entering someone's website, there's like, you'll see something called terms of use. Mm-hmm. And you kind of, by looking at and entering that website and using that website, you have impliedly agreed to those terms of use. So you want to make sure that your use of an image that you found on there complies with that terms of use, because now you've suddenly become subject to a contract by using that website, and contracts trump copyright. Yeah, so whatever you've contracted to is what controls. And you had a question.
Yes, I have a question, and that is, say for example, because I think there was a work of art that I had seen in a website, taken a picture, but I ended up and ordered that and bought it. If I used the original picture, I guess it would be a problem, but if I photographed what I already bought and I own, would that be mine?
You took a picture of a picture you bought.
Well, no, it wasn't actually a picture, it was a...
So kind of a, just a print, an art print? I'm not sure I understand what you bought.
This guy would be able to mold the things, and I bought the whole artifact that he actually made out of his hands, but I bought it from him.
Okay, so it's a sculpture?
Yes, it's a sculpture.
Okay, you bought a sculpture?
Yes.
And you want to take a picture of that sculpture and do what with the picture?
If I wanted to write a paper or research paper,
yeah,
and use that picture that I took from mm-hmm. the sculpture that
yeah.
I bought.
Yeah, you should be fine.
Okay.
But
if I use the one that he had used in advertising for it, then that is his.
I would say take your own picture. But still credit the, you know, of course credit the, you know, the sculptor and the name of the work, and yeah, I would just take your own picture if you can. Yeah, it's really complicated, you know, photographs. That really, I mean, just me walking up to something and taking a, I mean, it's a very, very thin copyright that someone holds, and where it's just you walking up with, like, say, your camera phone or something and taking a picture of something, because there's really, you know, whether that rises to the level of original, whether you hold copyright in that photo is what I'm getting at. It'd be very thin, if at all, because there's really not, what you've taken a photograph of, I mean, there's very little creativity involved, and you just walk it up and going, you know, snapping a picture. I doubt that you would really even have a copyright in that photograph.
So what about in a situation where, say, for example, this person does this sculpture as an artwork,
mm-hmm.
but you pull that and photograph it, but use it as a different thing. You may use it as a model, a scientific model or whatever.
Yeah.
Or a formula or a model of something.
Right, right.
So it was an art of work, but you've used it in time for
a that would be transformative use, and you know, looking at all the other factors, probably a very good, probably a very strong fair use case. And not a situation where you'd have to get anyone's permission. Good questions. Yes?
If you take a picture of someone,
mm-hmm.
can you use that in research? Do you have to, like, I photograph people?
So if you're doing kind of maybe like an anthropology
yeah.
or sociology, is it part of your research project that
yeah,
you're taking photographs
example,
of people?
I
or?
Would like to do a, I'm a PhD in public health.
Okay.
And I'm interested in skin disease.
Okay.
And I'm going to develop a natural product for acne and eczema. But I'm taking people's pictures,
mm-hmm.
their zits
mm-hmm.
and whatever. So
yeah. Yeah.
Are these are mine or not?
Those pictures are yours, yes.
Okay.
Yes, those pictures are yours. Some other things you might want to consider with that is whether or not you need to get a release from the folks that you took the pictures of, whether or not you need to go through IRB.
Okay.
There are other considerations there. Sorry. you might not, but check with your IRB. Check with your IRB folks, because even I get kind of fuzzy on all that of whether and getting releases is a whole other kind of, you know, and I've worked with students about, you know, if you're just taking random, you know, shots of folks in public, you know, maybe what you're...
No, they
no,
accept
I don't,
it.
I know you're
they
not.
They accept it because I have
yeah.
to come to you and say, yeah, how long do you have this? And they're like, oh, how about practice since I was young?
And chances,
you
and chances are, I mean, you probably, if it is really up close and the people themselves are not identifiable, probably
mm-hmm.
don't need a release.
Okay,
but
yeah, I don't
but
take,
it's still
I don't take,
yeah you're not
yeah,
right right
it's
but I would still I would check with IRB and you know when I say IRB you know I would check
yes,
and
I
make
know.
Sure that's not something that would be, because to me that screams IRB, but I might be wrong, because like I said, that's not my area of expertise, but
okay.
I would hate for you to get all the way to the end and be like, oh, you didn't comply with IRB, you can't do this. Yeah, so I would definitely check with them. Yes, ma'am.
I have one question about published article. For example, I have one article already published in the high impact factor journal. However, some people email me, requires me kind of send my article because it's not open access.
Yeah.
So based on, for example, some website like ResearchGate.
Yeah.
So basically, if I send, then it will validate.
I want to make sure. So you've published an article. Folks are aware that you've published this article. For whatever reason, wherever they're at, they don't have a subscription to the journal, and they would like to read this article. So they contact you privately and ask you to send them a PDF of the article. Is that what you're?
Yes.
Okay. Couple different things at work here. First of all, probably fair use to send send someone a personal copy of an article. Mm-hmm. And that's probably going to be fair use. What you don't want to do is, don't post that article somewhere publicly where anybody, so don't put it on ResearchGate, because chances are the copyright agreement you signed, not without knowing what journal, what publisher, chances are the copyright transfer agreement you signed would forbid you from posting that published PDF someplace publicly. Sharing it with somebody personally, providing them with a private personal copy, to me that's fair use. Another little wrinkle to be aware of is it your, where did you get that PDF? Is it your copy? Did you download it from a library database? Because, library databases, and Beth can, jump in, are subject to, all the electronic resources that you access through the university, through the library here, are subject to license agreements. We don't just have this content for free to do with whatever we want. We purchase access to it. We don't own the content. We're just given permission to access it. Mm-hmm. We pay a lot for that, they pay a lot. Mm-hmm. We pay a lot at UF too, to access it. Those license agreements, not copyright, control how that content can be used and shared. Many license agreements, and the thing that this is a problem because library users have no way of knowing this, but most license agreements include a provision called scholarly sharing, which do permit just that, permit you to download PDFs and share with, and they say in limited quantities and limited circumstances. But I think that you're probably fine doing that. But don't post that PDF somewhere like on ResearchGate or Mendeley or something, or on any other kind of, if you have a, faculty members, I run into this all the time, especially in the sciences. They have a website set up for like their lab or for their research, and they're always posting PDFs of the articles that they wrote. And then they get takedown notices from publishers, and they're just like, how can they? This is my article. I'm like, no, it's not. It's theirs. Did you sign a copyright transfer agreement? You gave it all away. It's not yours. And they're just like, what? Well, did you read your agreement?
No.
I just saw someone. They want to increase their citations.
Sure.
So they posted their blog.
Well, sure. But that's why you gotta read those agreements, and you need to negotiate with publishers to retain the right to do that.
So, for example, if my article already published in a journal, however, I want to go to kind of post. For post purpose,
a
conference. Do I need to ask permission?
So you're just incorporating pieces of that article, or maybe you have some data points or a figure or something on your conference poster, mm-hmm. or are you wanting to take the article to the conference and give it to everybody?
Oh, God.
What are you talking about?
So just post.
Just include parts of the article in the post. You're probably fine. Yeah, that's probably fair use. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Cite to the article though, even though you wrote
small
it again.
Amount.
Huh?
Small amount, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But if there's like some figures you want to reproduce or some kind of data points or something, you should be fine. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're going to be fine. Publishers aren't going to come after you for doing that. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes. Down there at the end of the table first.
What about self-publishing? What is.
Oh, is that what you.
What is up with that? Like, how do you cite something from self-publish? I don't even know a lot about self-publishing.
What do you think self-publishing is? I mean, is it something that someone's wrote a, I mean, when I think self-publishing, I mean, I think of someone who's written a romance novel and are selling it through Amazon. I mean, to me, that's self-publishing. I mean, there's a lot of that.
What if you were writing something and maybe that romance novel is relevant to what you're writing?
And I'm not knocking on romance novels.
But this person has self-published this work.
Where are you finding it at? I guess that's...
Well, let's say it's a Kindle book, and you're wanting to cite something in that Kindle book that has been self-published through, like, Amazon.
Yes, yes.
How do you go about citing something like that?
I would cite the... you know, the title, the author, you know, just as you would any other book. And the only thing you're not going to have is you are not going to, and again, I would refer to, you know, because I don't know if style, I haven't looked at a style manual in a while, if they are giving any citation formats for self-published materials. But, you know, in that situation, give as much identifying information you can. So give the author, give the, you know, the title of the author, if there's particular pages that you want to cite. And in the parenthetical information or after the colon, again, whatever citation format, you might want to provide, you know, maybe the link to the book on Amazon or whatever other place that you've made a link to wherever you downloaded this, whether it's a, you know, ebook or whatever it is. That's how I would cite to it. Because you're not going to have a publisher or a city, things that we would see in a typical commercially published book and a citation to it. Did that answer? Okay. So yeah, I mean, anyone can self-publish, but usually, like you said, there's not a publisher involved. So you just don't have that as part of your citation. Instead, I would just include a URL from where you got it. Yeah.
That was actually my question.
That was your question? Okay.
Yeah, but I had a second part to it. Okay. If for some reason it wasn't like fair, like if you had to get permission, would you just like contact the author?
I'm going to get to that.
Oh, okay.
We're going to get to that. So, yes?
Sorry, this is something you're going to get too.
I'm sorry.
the thing that always is really blurry for me is like when you find, like you're searching Google Images for example, I'm doing my like capstone project and I Googled research and I come up with all these pictures of cartoons doing research.
Yeah.
And obviously they come from a website.
Yeah.
So I have always felt like, okay, it's educational.
Yeah.
It's kind of transformative because I'm using it differently
than
how they use it. And it's a small part of their whole website.
Yeah.
And then I just put it on my website, and that one is
tricky, and I run into this a lot with faculty when they're producing slides that they want to use in lectures and things, that they, oh yeah, I just did a search on Google Images. And what I say is, well, I'm not going to make you go back and change everything you did, but going forward, let's adopt a little bit some best practices. The first thing I would do is when you are looking for images, because, you know, maybe not so much with cartoons and things, but, I mean, you can find the same picture on 150 different websites. And if those folks used it in a way that was infringing, you know, without analyzing where they got it and how they used it, just because your use is legal, you don't cure. If you download something that was already infringing, your use doesn't be, even though your use would qualify as legal, you can't use illegal content in a legal way. It doesn't cure that pre-existing illegality. So you always want to make sure, whenever possible, that you're getting it from the original source, which I realize is sometimes impossible. So going forward, a better practice would be, is maybe to find something that's been licensed through Creative Commons. And you can go to especially if you're just looking for an image of a thing. You don't need, you know, if you're not talking about, I need this particular painting by this particular author. I just need some images that represent research, like kind of what you described. If you go to search.creativecommons.org. Search.creativecommons.org. And it will lay, if you search through that, it will still search Google Images, Flickr. I don't know if Photo Bucket still exists or not. You can search for images, you can search for sound files, and it lays a filter over top. So you will still search Google Images, but you're only going to be retrieving results where the person has licensed them through Creative Commons. Creative Commons is for the, are any of you familiar with Creative Commons?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Lots of nodding. That's great.
We have to do that in like Creative, put a Creative Commons license in our first class.
So that would be going forward. That would be my recommendation is to do that. Is to make sure, you know.
But so even the one that in Google Image, when you go onto add more search and you say.
You can do it that way too. But not sometimes, you know. That's not it. To me, it's easier. For me, it's easier just to start Creative Commons. But yes, in Google Image Search, you can open up the advanced search and you can check the box as well to only retrieve Creative Commons licensed works. That is another way to do it, yes.
Cool.
But that would be my recommendation. But you know, the fact of the matter is, I mean, and again, it's about risk assessment. You know, look at how, if you can't be exactly sure, okay, was this used legally? Did the person that actually created this image give permission for it to be included on this website? Then you kind of look at, okay, well, what's my risk if I go ahead and use it?
They're probably not going to find it and then go through the trouble of suing me over it.
Well, they're not going to. And the situation is, if it's, you know, as many images are, have been reproduced 1,000 times on 1,000 different websites, you might get a takedown notice, and is what you're going to get. And this is you know, as long as we're talking about images, you know, this is the same with YouTube. And again, this is something I talk to faculty about a lot as well, when they want to use content they have found in YouTube in their classes. And a lot of what is on YouTube is in violation of someone's copyright, because YouTube doesn't really filter. I mean, they will allow anyone pretty much to put up anything. They rely upon kind of self, you know, they rely upon copyright holders to alert them when something has been put up that infringes their copyright, and then institute the takedown process through the Digital Millennium Copyright Act and all that. So, you know, I tell a faculty member to evaluate whatever, you know, and again, they can provide a link to their students. And it's not illegal just to give somebody a link, even if it's a link to something that is infringement. That's not illegal. Question is it ethical? Should we be pointing folks to infringing content? That's between you and you know, whomever. But it's not illegal. But it's also a matter of sustainability. Something that's there when you're searching and preparing your class or whatever, or if you're working on a project. Something that's there in October of 2015, and it was up there infringing, you know, an infringement of someone's copyright, might not be there in 6 or 9 months. So it's, you know, if you're looking at things that you find online that may or may not be up there legally, just know that you are running the risk of it being taken, you know, if you're using a URL and pointing to it, it might not be there. So it's probably not a good practice to do. Excellent questions, you guys. Thank you. I love it. This is what I was hoping for. Is that would be.
Christine, it's 1 o'clock. Just
to wait. Thank you. Okay. So we still have one more factor to go through. So the final factor is, you know, is your use going to impact the market for the original? So is your incorporation of this copyrighted work in any way going to be taking profits away from the copyright holder? Courts have also recently said, you know, is there already a licensing scheme in place? You know, can I get permission for, you know, reasonably easily and for a reasonable cost? Sometimes, you know, if we're talking about out-of-print works in particular, there is no market anymore. And so usually if it's something that's out-of-print, no longer available, the author's dead, the publisher has closed, you know, there's no one to even go to for permission, we'll probably push the envelope on those other three factors, how much of it you're using, if it's commercial or not, because there is no market to even be impacted. So that's what this fourth factor looks at. It's just whether or not you're giving it to someone for free when otherwise they could be paying for it. Yes?
Could you argue that you're affecting the market in a positive way?
Absolutely you can. Absolutely you can. That your use is actually driving people to it and encouraging them to buy, and that argument has been made.
Okay.
Successfully has been made. Yes?
Yeah, I was going to mention that too, because there are people on YouTube that review certain types of things like movies or games or books, and even though they're using that particular thing.
Yeah. But see, that's probably fair use. That would probably be fair use anyway if they are reviewing something and they're not really making the entire film available necessarily online.
Mm-hmm.
good questions. All right, so say you've done your analysis, and like I said, most of the things that you all are probably going to be doing are going to qualify as fair use. It's one of the situations where I had a graduate student come to me was he was wanting to include, and really he was just wanting to include it as an appendix, like the entire score of a contemporary opera, and couldn't get permission. He's like, well, can I just go ahead and use it? I'm like, no, no. I mean, you either just need to, you know, you're just going to have to take it out. So like I said, most generally, the things you all are probably going to be incorporating into your writings is going to be fair use. But in the chance that you are in a situation where you feel like you need to get permission, how do I go about doing it? Well, the first step is actually probably the hardest. Who the heck do you get permission from? As I've already said many, many times, rarely is the author the copyright holder. If you're talking about a journal article or a book, it's usually not going to be the author who holds copyright anymore. They have likely transferred it to a publisher. Not all publishers handle their own permissions. So my suggestion is that you go to the publisher's website, and usually there will be a link called permissions. Some publishers have a form that you fill out right online. And usually, you know, they're going to ask you what the title of the work is that you're using, what portion of that work you're going to be using, and why you're using it. And that's usually a drop-down, and usually this thesis or dissertation is part of that drop-down. Now, some publishers are pretty flexible when talking about using it in dissertations and will grant permission without charging you any money for use in dissertation. But there are a whole lot that will. That will come back and say, yeah, you can use it, but pay us $100. Hmm. So you, first of all, you want to make really, really sure. Are you really sure it's not fair use before you go through those steps? As I said, some publishers, you know, will have that form on their website. A lot of publishers, a lot of content producers have contracted with a company known as Copyright Clearance Center, and you have to go through your permission requests through them. So that's kind of the process for text-based works, articles, books. If talking about artworks, usually that's going to be the artist. Just 1 minute, okay? And so, you know, a lot of this in this digital age, a lot of this can be done online, but you may have to do the old-fashioned, you know, emailing somebody, finding an actual physical address and contacting them. If it is, you know, an older work, and maybe it is, you know, maybe it is a situation where the author is still the copyright holder and they are deceased, a lot of times they are going to establish as part of their estate a literary trust. And the Harry Ransom Center down at, in Texas actually maintains a database called Watch, and they maintain a database of contacts for copyright holders. So that's a good resource to check, particularly for literary or artists that are deceased. For other types of works, music, film, generally they all use also a third-party licensing agency. I've given a couple of examples here, but there are certainly more of different licensing agencies. So that's kind of the route if you're going to get permission. You're probably going to be, in all likelihood, going to be dealing with a third-party licensing agency like Copyright Clearance Center or the Motion Picture Licensing Corporation or ASCAP or whatever. There's different places. So you in the purple. What was your question? I just wanted to get through this little bit of stuff. So what was your question?
You said make sure it's fair use. Like if you start like going through the process of doing copyright and you're like, oh wait, it is fair use.
Yeah.
Is it too late? Like, do you still have to get permission? Like
once
you give up on the idea of fair use.
Yeah.
Is there any way to go back?
Well, sure.
Okay. I give up and it is fair use as long as like.
So you mean you've already requested permission and you're like, on second thought, this is fair. Is that what you mean?
Yes.
I have a hard time with it. If you've already asked someone for permission, mm-hmm. and they've said yes, you can have permission, and you have to pay money, and you're like, on second thought, it's fair use. I don't feel like that's right.
Yeah.
I mean,
because you've
kind of put them on notice. You're going to use it,
and you've acknowledged that you have.
So you want to be really sure before you go through that step. So now we're going to switch gears and talk about you as a copyright holder. So you are the copyright holder of your thesis or dissertation. The university doesn't own it. The graduate school doesn't own it. You are that owner. In fact, you're the owner of any paper you write when you are in school. So if some faculty member, so say you've written a paper for a class and a faculty member has posted your paper as either a really wonderful example or a really bad example for other students, and they haven't asked your permission, you have the right to complain. They cannot use, I mean, and it might be a FERPA thing as well, but they can't use your papers. I mean, it's still yours. It's not the teachers, it's not the universities. Copyright protection in your dissertation or thesis is automatic, so as soon as that work is complete, and whether it's just living on a thumb drive or on your iPad or on your laptop, even if it has not, you know, officially been turned in and published yet, you are already the copyright holder in that dissertation. You do not have to do anything. You don't have to register. You don't even have to include the little copyright symbol. I think registration is a good idea. And when you are finishing up the process, you will have the option to have ProQuest file that registration for you. It's not a hard process and it's not expensive. I think ProQuest charges, I think it's $45 if you do it on your own and $55 if ProQuest does it for you. It's a really simple form online. Like I said, I think it's a good idea for a multitude of reasons, which we can or don't have to discuss. So especially if it is highly creative work or something that you intend to reuse later, I think registration is a good idea. So you're going to have, so as far as publishing your dissertation or thesis, right at the outset, you're going to have two options presented to you right away. One of those options is going to be, I keep mentioning ProQuest. ProQuest is a commercial entity that hosts a database known as the Theses and Dissertations Abstract or something like that database. You're going to have a couple of options. You're going to be presented with an agreement by ProQuest. You're going to have a couple of options with that agreement. You can just make your abstract available. So if someone searches that database, all they're going to find is your abstract. You can make the entire work available to anyone that has, to view and read online, to anyone that has a subscription to the ProQuest database. Or you can elect to make it available open access through ProQuest, meaning anybody can find it and read it. Does not give your copyright away. You are still the copyright holder. You're not transferring any rights to ProQuest. All you're doing is giving ProQuest a non-exclusive license. You're just granting them permission to make that work available for the purposes of that database. So essentially for someone to search and find and read your work. If someone wants to use portions of your work, they still have to cite you. They can't, they can't plagiarize you. They can't claim copyright. You are still the copyright holder. So a way of just getting your work out there found and read. The second option is going to be depositing in the institutional repository here, known as NC Docs. And again, all you're doing is you're not giving away copyright, you're merely granting the university permission to make that work available in a publicly accessible way. So again, so people can find it, people can read it, cite to it, which is all good things. I believe NC Docs will allow you to place an embargo, yes?
Yes,
an embargo?
Through the graduate school.
Through the graduate school, yeah. Okay. You can place an embargo, and what an embargo is that if you go ahead and put it in there, but it's not going to be the whole, now they can, someone can search and still find the title, correct? Not even that?
No, they're not available at all.
Not available at all, okay.
The only thing that would be available is like the person's profile, but the article would not be available.
So not even just the title of it?
No.
Okay. So it would not be available for whatever period of time you specify, and how many months?
So one, and there are 1 and 2 year options for all programs, I believe, and then creative writing also has a 5 year option.
Has a 5 year option, okay.
And they can be extended by request through the graduate school.
Okay. So whether or not you want to have an embargo is really gonna be dependent upon what you intend to do with your work after you graduate, which we're gonna kind of talk about next. If you intend to, turn around and maybe if you're writing a dissertation, maybe you are going to turn it into a monograph manuscript, you want to publish it as a book, maybe you're going to add a little bit to it. Maybe you want to chunk up the chapters and you want to publish them as articles. Some publishers may treat your deposit in an institutional repository or being openly accessible through ProQuest may treat that as prior publication and might refuse to publish it on that basis. So before you sign these forms, it's really important for you to think about, what do I want to do with this later? And that's going to inform your decision about whether you want to make it available open access, whether you want to put an embargo on it. So, you know, these things you have to be kind of thinking about ahead of time. You don't want to be trying to decide it when it's, you know, you're trying to graduate and you got that paperwork in front of you. Again, this public, I told you about this chart when we were talking about whether or not you can use previously published articles in your dissertation. Again, publishers have policies on this, whether or not they treat deposit in an IR or in some other publicly accessible repository, whether they treat that as prior publication. It's really up to individual publishers. Some do, some don't. It's really kind of 50-50 based on the ones I've, and I certainly haven't looked at all of them, but I've looked at a lot of the major ones. Other things to think about, you know, like again, we've been talking about signing copyright transfer agreements. If you are thinking about publishing portions of your work as articles, do some homework on the journals or the publishers that you're thinking about publishing with before you submit your manuscript to them, to discover what their policies are on copyright transfer, on perhaps depositing a version of your work in the IR. Do you retain the right to do that? And a place that you can do that is through this website called Sherpa Romeo. Wonderful site. You search for the journal, you search by journal title, because my recommendation is how you search that site. And it's going to pull up an entry with a couple of different fields telling you, first of all, you know, do you retain copyright, or is it transferred to the publishers? And sometimes they will have a link to the actual text of the copyright transfer agreement. Do they allow you to retain the right to post a version of your work, whether that is the pre-peer review version of the manuscript, so your Word document? Is it the publisher's PDF? Do I have the right to put that in the IR or on ResearchGate? Will I retain the right to do that? So look research the journals that you're thinking about publishing in before you even submit your manuscript, so you're going to know before, you know, it becomes time to submit what you might be faced with. And that's a good place to do that. Yes?
Quick question about, you mentioned about the ProQuest UMI.
Yes.
So we can select traditional publishing or open access.
Correct.
So which one you suggest?
Which one is what?
You suggest.
I suggest open access because honestly, I mean, the royalties you're going to make if ProQuest sells it are going to be so minuscule. No one's going to make money on their dissertations. To me, it's much more valuable to have your work reach the widest audience possible, especially if you are anticipating, if you're going to be applying for academic jobs. It's a nice, easy place you can point people to, as well as NC Docs, so if they want to look at your dissertation, you know, then it's out there, and people are going to be able to find it and read it, and perhaps cite to it, which is going to be much more easy if it's available openly accessible way, which whether through ProQuest or NC Docs, really. Yeah, or both. Yeah, double exposure. So it's just really about think about what I mean, or you know, we were talking about this morning about how sometimes dissertations are up there for a while, and someone will come back and be like, "Oh, I don't want it up there." You know, we've had faculty. We're doing some retrospective scanning of dissertations. Dissertations that were written by UF graduate students, like in the 60s and 70s, we are going back and scanning their paper copies or dissertations and putting them in our IR. Most of them are flattered that we're doing this, but we will get the occasional faculty members like, "Oh, that piece of crap, I don't want," you know, because they're just not proud of what they wrote, you know, 20 years. And so, you know, if it's not your best work, if you feel like, "Oh, maybe in 10, 15 years, I'm not going to want people to be reading that." I mean, you really, and I know you can't have a crystal ball and know, but, just be thinking about how you would ideally, I mean, do you want people to read it? I would say don't evaluate it on monetarily, because this is not going to be some profit making. I'm telling you, your grandma might buy a copy of it, or your mom. I just don't think that, I mean, and y'all can correct me, but my experience has been that these people are not making big royalty checks off of their dissertations.
I can't even understand my husband's dissertation in the title of it. He's a chemist. I'm like, what are you talking about? Nobody can.
But I mean, if you really do feel like this is great stuff, I want to publish this as an article or as a book someday, then I would definitely, lock it down. Because I would hate for a publisher to say to you, sorry, it's already out there, we're not publishing this. And I believe that is the end. So here's some of the links. If you have other questions, so the UNCG specific links about submitting to NC Docs, even link to the ETD's office's FAQ, which I did read through, Beth's scholarly communications website, and then some other resources. I was talking about this publisher policy chart. It's on this is my website. It's on that page there. I'm sorry? ProQuest themselves has a really great guide to copyright. It was written by Kenny Cruz. And the University of Michigan, they've done a really excellent guide as well to copyright for dissertations and for graduate students. So some other resources that you might want to check out. So, any last questions?
Before the questions, I'm going to put my iPad. Send it around if you want to put your email in. Then I can email everybody the things.
Thank you.
All right. Who wants to go? We'll just go clockwise. You in the purple.
My question was about prior publishing. If you were to put something in ProQuest or NC Docs and realize down the line, I actually want this to be published by something else. If you take it down, is it still considered prior publishing?
Probably. Yep. I would say most publishers, if it's been out, because they're going to, or you could lie to them, they're going to ask you, has this been out? They will ask, has this been out there? And I don't advocate lying. I wouldn't take it down and then, because chances are there's some digital footprint of it out there somewhere. So even if you took it down, I wouldn't do that. Yeah, not going to work. Well, there was a whole lot of hands. Okay, go ahead.
If, for example, you're working at something and you have a core, or we'd say a model that you want to develop, and this model can be able to go in any direction so that you can be able to publish a paper in this direction and then add something that keeps reproducing.
Sure.
How do you secure that until you're ready to go into all these other detours? Do you kind of put the heart of it, or just the model or the theory in one thing and then come back and revisit and use the application of this theory in a context?
Yeah, are you talking about you don't want other people to see it, or is that what you're concerned about, or do you just want to be able to
put it there and somebody else picks that and runs in another direction and you want to?
But you really can't prevent them from doing that. Because that would be, that would probably be their right of fair use to take this model and use it in some different way with maybe their own data set or for their own purposes. Honestly, that's what we want to encourage is new knowledge, new discovery, new research. And if it's based upon something you did, wouldn't you want that? That's pretty flattering. So I don't think you'd want to lock that down and prevent that just because you might want to do it later.
Thank you.
Who else? I know that I saw, I didn't imagine it. There were a whole lot of
people. So the same thing, like you said, he has a model, but if it's a formula, for me, for example,
whether a formula, I'm not slamming yet, but you came in a little bit late and you missed when I was talking about things that are and are not copyrighted. A formula might not be able to be copyrighted, a formula standing alone. That's kind of a process, and you may not be able to copyright a formula. There's like all kinds of algebraic and equations and things and that's not copyrightable. Patents. That's going to be a patent thing.
I would talk to, is this still called the Office of Technology transfer.
Yeah, so tech transfer folks are who you're going to want to talk to about something like that. Then you're getting into, there's copyright only protects certain kinds of things. Trademarks protect certain kinds of things. Patents.
So then
you're talking about a patent.
Yeah, so you're going to write about it. Like, let's say if I deliver this and then I want to write it, I will want So then do I tell
if you if you're writing about something that is going to be that you're going to want a patent, I would be doing your patent kind of in conjunction with doing your paper.
The person you might want to talk to is Lisa Goble, G-O-B-B-L-E. You can find her on, you can just put her in the email, she'll pop up. She's in charge of technology transfer stuff.
The late ma'am in the teal shirt, you had a question?
Yeah, okay, here's my situation. I have a tool that I want to use as part of my data collection. And it's in the literature. I've got a whole series of articles. I kind of track back and back and back trying to find it. And it's called, you know, other people are calling it the Gladstone Scale.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
The original author did not. She has not published anything else.
Yeah.
I can't find that it's copyrighted.
So is it her name? Is that where Gladstone
it's
is coming
her
from?
Name.
Yeah. Yeah.
And actually, she's not at the institution where she was. I think I have found an email for her.
Yeah. So you're just wanting to use this scale for your research,
right?
And what is your? I wouldn't worry about permission.
Okay.
But you would
I
would cite to the original, and you can write a footnote that says, you know, cite to the original article or book, whatever it is that it occurs to you. And I would even say, you know, this has now become known as the Gladstone Scale. And if you want to give, you know, as an example, another article where it has been mm-hmm. used, that's how I would construct a footnote about it. And what you would do is you would probably also use that same name and then footnote that and say, cite to the original and then just, you know, where it kind of used. So I would say that's fine. That would be adequate.
Okay. So as long as I have documented the
mm-hmm.
source
yep.
of it, I don't need to track down and try to find this way in
now.
England.
Facebook.
No.
Facebook. You can be friends.
No, you don't need to.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Any
I'll
other
so much here then.
Yes.
Just
the I was wondering about whenever you're, like, if you add your dissertation to something and then you decide, hey, I want to use that as published, if you cite it instead and then add a significant amount to it, do you
mm-hmm.
think the publisher would be like, oh, okay, as long as you, like, cite?
Depends on the publisher. I'm sorry. and the reason why I know this is because I just helped a faculty member with a book where she has been using significant portions of articles that she has previously published, but has done, you know, changed things around, added things, and we had to fight tooth and nail with them to convince them why she didn't need to get, get permission. And I've had other publishers who, you know, don't. I mean, it really is going to depend on the publisher or that, you know, the editor that you're working with.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Even if you. Like, go ahead and
you're going to have to still
access.
Cite to it. Hmm?
Even if you post something as open access.
You're still going to have to cite to it.
Well, yeah, but it's just.
But whether they treat it as.
It's
just going to depend.
Okay.
It's just really going to depend. Yes?
So, question about dissertation, a manuscript dissertation. It should be quick, because I think you've addressed
it. I don't know if you all have a place to be. We have,
We're good till 3:30. So.
Okay, all right.
just trying to figure out the timing and what to restrict and what not to restrict. So if I heard you correctly, it might not be a bad idea to lock it down in ProQuest.
Yeah.
And then...
And NCDocs.
As far as the timing, though, should I not submit to the journals until I have my dissertation finished at the university, and then, which includes the decision about ProQuest and NCDocs, whether, and should I put it, the if I put the embargo on it, though, I'm still going to have to let any publisher know that it has been submitted to NCDocs, because I don't think that's an option.
Right, it's not.
It's not an option.
Right.
So I would have
right.
to
in a program.
But you would tell them it's in there, but it's embargoed for, you know, 12 months, 24 months.
Okay.
And if it's embargoed, they're going to probably be okay with it.
Okay.
If you say it's embargoed, it's dark, it's not visible.
Not
they're going to be okay.
Okay.
With
it. So that would be the way to go.
Yes.
And then just make sure
yes.
the publishers I submit to know
it's dark. Yep.
And if there's for some reason you are working with a publisher who says, oh, like,
it needs to have a longer embargo, you can talk to the graduate school and explain your circumstance, that this is, I'm working on publication, and they can potentially help you extend that if needed.
Okay, thank you. Probably got time for one more.
Okay, thank you. So basically, when I finish my dissertation, if I want to publish two papers, then basically because the dissertation, I am the copyright holder, so I can publish it from my dissertation. I don't need to have permission. Right. However, if because we can select manuscript dissertation, for example, at school or nursing, we can select two manuscript, not traditional dissertation. So if I have not finished my dissertation, however, one paper I always submit to the journal. So I need to the permission from journal to put this article into my dissertation.
I'm not sure I'm following you at all. I'm trying. Sorry. I mean, has it been published or not?
Already published. I mean, for example,
once it's been published, you can't publish it again. You can put it in your dissertation, but you can't submit it to another. Some other journal, if it's already been published by one journal, some other journal is not going to publish the same article.
Because in our school, my school policy asks us if one article already, for example, for our dissertation, we can have two paper, one maybe later review paper, because another one is database paper. So basically, the literature review paper, maybe we already submit to the journal.
Yeah.
So once published, if we want to put the article in the UN, because not traditional. So basically, if already published, we need to have the permission, right?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, to publish it again, yeah. Yeah. Uh-huh. Not necessarily to include it in your dissertation, but if you're going to commercially publish it again.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So it's good, all finished then published.
Yeah.
There's no question about the copyright.
I think, if I'm understanding you correctly, I think, but I'm still not sure I understand.
Well, y'all can keep discussing it. I want to say thank you for everybody that came today.